Hey everyone, me Kevin here. It is a Tuesday, December 7th, and we've got to talk about Omicron. I've got a full outline of updates regarding Omicron, and there's some things in here that are concerning, but other things that are actually quite positive that have come out over the last few days, and I think they're very important for not only financial markets, but for us to know. And we're already able to track some mobility data to see how consumers are reacting to Omicron, which we'll talk about all of that in this video. So let's go ahead and jump right into some of the latest information that we have regarding Omicron. So we're going to use this flowchart here to follow along. Here's what's very important. Look, we know that we had four cases in Botswana in Pfizer vaccinated individuals. This set off a massive scare that, wait a minute, what if Omicron is just entirely resistant to our vaccines? We're going to talk about that in just a moment because there are two things that vaccines do, and it's really important to keep that in mind because prior illness has this effect as well. So whether you've had COVID or you've had a vaccine, I think these two things are very important to pay attention to. But in South Africa, it's also worth noting that 20.4% of the South African population is infected with HIV, at least according to AVERT. That means one in five people are immunocompromised with HIV. So even if we started getting negative news out of South Africa, that individuals in South Africa are having worse symptoms because of the Omicron variant, it's entirely possible that one in five of those individuals have HIV and are therefore immunocompromised and would be expected to have worse outcomes, which is terrible and unfortunate. But let's understand this about vaccines and prior illness. First, according to Rockefeller University, we know that the vaccines are at least somewhere. We believe that the vaccines are at least still likely, at least still somewhat effective in preventing severe illness and so would prior illness. And here's why. A vaccine does two things for you. It may even do more things, but two primary things. A vaccine encourages the production of antibodies and T cells. Your body tends to produce T cells. We know this because Penn Medicine published a report that mRNA vaccines or prior illness encourage the body's T cell immune response, which is really important. Why is this so important? Because take a look at this. What's important is that antibodies, they target specific regions of receptors on the spike protein. So remember when you have the spike protein, I'm just gonna kind of draw it like this, it's not exactly what it's shaped like, but when you have 30 plus mutations on the actual tip of the spike protein, it becomes a lot more difficult for the antibodies to recognize that, oh wait, this is what I should be attacking. However, T cells are different. According to Rockefeller University and other studies at this point, T cells, rather than just attacking the spike, or the tip rather, the landing receptors, you know, this would be the right here, the receptors, the binding receptors of spike protein, specifically the binding domain and the N-terminal. These are technical terms for that. Antibodies target these. Rather than targeting just this as a T cell, T cells target the entire spike. And this leads Rockefeller University to say that, hey, look, we're going to have less efficacy in an antibody response because antibodies are targeting the tip and those landing receptors. But the T cell body response, which vaccines or prior illness encourage, can actually help us still fight the Omicron variant because T cells are targeting the entire spike and not just that landing receptor. This is really good. Now, what's bad and what comes along with this is microbiologists over at USC, USC, by the way, was one of the first labs to sequence Omicron. They thought that Delta was going to be the beginning of the end, and they're concerned that, hey, look, even though we might still have some efficacy from our current vaccines or prior illness against Omicron, the big issue that you have is if Delta is not the beginning of the end, and we get a big surprise like Omicron, that means more and more people are likely to get COVID. And even if Omicron is less severe, you're likely to create new mutations because more people having it leads to not only, more cases, that leads to not only more cases, but more hospitalizations, more mutations, more deaths. And that is exactly their quote here. They say, as long as there are large numbers of unvaccinated, I'm going to interject there and say, or people who have previously had COVID, the virus will continue to keep mutating and spreading. And so they mention, USC mentions, that it's very possible this virus is here to stay and we're going to continue to essentially deal with these sorts of variants. Now, the World Health Organization does believe that the existing vaccines will help prevent severe cases, and it's probably because of that T cell response, but you're definitely seeing a reduction in efficacy so far in the vaccines or prior illness because of the failure potentially of antibodies to be able to respond appropriately or as appropriately. Worth noting as well, though, that we're going to get a lot of news about things like this. A holiday Christmas party in Spain. 68 ICU nurses, according to Reuters, tested positive for COVID from a December 1st party with 173 people. All of the people who went had either a negative test or boosters. There was some suggestion that maybe was it the food, but we've known for a while that surface transmission is very unlikely with COVID, that the survival of the coronavirus on surfaces is not substantially long and certainly not long enough to lead to transmission. So we haven't really seen surface transmission. Most of it is air-based. And so this is where I made the assumption. Reuters didn't say this, so I want to make that very clear when it's my opinion or what Reuters mentioned. Reuters mentioned food. I thought that was very weird. I personally think it's more likely that, look, you've had colder weather in Spain. You've had weather somewhere in the 40s to mid-50s in the last couple of weeks. And so usually what happens is when people go inside and they have a party or have an event, ventilation just isn't that good. And we know with certainty that poor ventilation is the perfect way to spread COVID. It's not just masking. It's not just vaccinations. We got to be real. There's a third prong of fighting COVID, and that's proper ventilation or filtration. See, I doubt, for example, and it wasn't mentioned either, that this party with 173 people had, let's say, one industrial grade HEPA filter with UV light every 400 feet or every 400 square feet. I doubt that, right? And that's unfortunately been something that I believe has led this pandemic to last a lot longer is this failure of whether it's media or the science community or whatever to really encourage filtration more than we do. Because certainly if people are going to a party, they're going to take their masks off, they're going to eat, and they're going to drink, right? Especially if they all think they're vaccinated. And as we're already seeing, people are still catching COVID, or vaccinated or negative. People are still catching COVID, even though they're vaccinated. And that is because of that antibody, that decline in antibody response. Anyway, we already know that breakthrough cases were common even with Delta. It's just that symptoms have been a lot less severe. But anyway, it's worth noting that we're going to have events like this that and these outbreak events that are going to happen, Omicron or not. Keep in mind, we still have Delta this winter, and we expect cases to rise during the winter and then go back down again in the summer. And hopefully after the summer, coronavirus is just gone, but something to keep an eye on. Only so far, 7 confirmed cases of Omicron in Spain. Dr. Fauci this morning did mention that, quote, Omicron is almost certainly not more severe than Delta. And there is some suggestion that it could actually be less severe, that maybe because it's mutated so much, it's actually less aggressive than the Delta variant, which has less mutations than our original Alpha variant. But anyway, Dr. Fauci does mention that, quote, it will still take another couple of weeks, at least in South Africa, and longer throughout the rest of the world, to see what the levels of severity are for Omicron. Though markets overall seem to be relatively enthused that Omicron is unlikely to be substantially severe. It's more of a question of, is this going to lead to new variants, right? And we'll talk about the community's response and mobility in just a moment. But also worth noting that the GlaxoSmithKline COVID-19 vaccine, the plant-based one, was determined to be 75% effective against multiple variants, but it was not tested against Omicron. The market also, quick note on market, the market does seem to be more fearful about Powell than Omicron. I misspelled that there. But does seem to be more fearful about Powell's interest rate hikes than really Omicron right now. And we'll talk about mobility in just a moment. In South Africa, real-world observations have been indicating that symptoms so far have been largely mild. However, it's worth noting, according to Bloomberg, a lot of these cases have been in younger individuals. And of course, we're going to expect more mild cases in younger individuals. It could also take more time for severe symptoms to develop. But then again, we've been talking about Omicron for somewhere around 10 days now. And we haven't really seen indications yet that Omicron is going to be substantially more severe. Mutations, we already know. We've got twice as many mutations as the Delta variant. It is, of course, worth noting that preventing severe disease is probably the most important thing for all of us to consider about, or consider in general when it comes to COVID, because consider this, the Becker Hospital Review, this was published on November 29th, published that 238 U.S. COVID patients have received lung transplants from August 2020 through October of 2021, and this is a 10x increase of lung transplants for COVID patients at the same time as other causes like emphysema, cystic fibrosis, pulmonary fibrosis. These instances of lung transplants actually declining. So definitely some concerns regarding long COVID. Here's another notable update. This particularly is a copy and paste from Bloomberg. I just want to be transparent that this particular update here is a copy and paste. It says that initial data from South Africa doesn't show a resulting surge of hospitalizations due to the Omicron variant in South Africa. This is really good. Remember, this actually becomes important again because remember, one in five individuals in South Africa are HIV positive. Anthony Fauci said the U.S., which has seen Omicron spread to at least 16 states, is reevaluating its travel ban on 8 Southern African countries. The UK will require all incoming travelers, regardless of vaccination status, to take a pre-flight COVID test. We already do this in the United States anyway. France is trying to avoid more restrictions, and a new poll suggests that Germans now support mandatory vaccinations in Germany, obviously something that is unlikely to be very popular here in America. But stories like this certainly aren't going to increase the likelihood of seeing more vaccinations in individuals who are not vaccinated. Reuters reported that a young student was studying in Malaysia. It was 19 years old, ended up catching the Omicron variant, came back after visiting family in South Africa, complied with pre-departure testing, complied with on-arrival testing, was fully vaccinated, stayed home during quarantined for 10 days, and had Omicron. This is despite being tested and fully vaccinated. So you're definitely seeing this elevated transmissibility, but no particular issues here. And at least when this person was traveling with either relatives or friends or the other 5 individuals, all of them tested negative. So I see this as actually mostly positive, though definitely concerning that more vaccinated and tested individuals are experiencing Omicron. The Pfizer CEO mentioned this morning that this faster spread that we're seeing with Omicron is likely to lead to another mutation, or that it could lead to another mutation, and that is certainly a risk factor. But it does seem like a lot of industry folks are suggesting that Omicron itself, maybe not necessarily the biggest thing to worry about, though it's something to pay attention to. We do have a report here from CNBC from today that the South African Medical Research Council, in a report released Saturday, said most patients admitted to the hospital who had COVID didn't need supplemental oxygen, and we are seeing a rise in COVID cases there. COVID cases are up 400% from within a week of Omicron being discovered in South Africa. Now, part of my questioning here is I wonder how much more they're testing now, because it's also worth noting that a lot of the individuals here, take a look at this. The report also noted that many patients were admitted for other medical reasons and were then found to have COVID. So it does make you wonder if hospitals are just ramping up their testing in South Africa. Is it spreading more? Or are we testing more? Are people getting tested more because now they've become sort of the ground zero for Omicron? The Indian Medical Association warned today of a massive potential for a third wave because of Omicron. However, only so far 23 individuals have been affected. And going forward, sentiment and mobility-wise, folks, mobility is remaining strong. Traffic in Beijing, for example, similar levels. Traffic throughout the United States, according to Bloomberg, a report this morning. Mobility levels are strong. Oil is remaining stable because of this. And so far, it really feels like folks are just going about their regular COVID in sort of related lives, that COVID is just something that we've learned to deal with. When we have to, we leave home with a mask, when we're required to. But otherwise, Omicron so far does not appear to be something that is creating substantial fear to the point where individuals are, let's say, canceling their travel plans or they're staying home more. It really seems like thus far we're in this wait and see pattern of, okay, is Omicron maybe a little bit more contagious, but maybe it's less severe? Is it going to lead to another variant? Should we then just hang out, stay strong, and stay safe, and then wait to see if other variants come up? But otherwise, markets are not substantially reacting anymore to Omicron, and I really believe Friday's sell-off was substantially more of a response to Jerome Powell than it was to Omicron. Now, we'll stay up to date with updates on Omicron, but these are some of the latest thoughts and research that I have on Omicron. Look, if we summarize positives, T-cell response, very, very good. Yes, vaccines prior illness might be less effective, but we're still getting that T-cell response that's leading to a more mild symptoms. We expect that if we are getting more severe symptoms in South Africa, there's a potential of seeing a higher incidence of more severe cases because of a 20% positivity rate for HIV. However, we're actually getting reports of more mild cases in South Africa, not worse, despite this, or in spite of this, right? We're, of course, seeing holiday parties and gatherings of individuals catching COVID, which we're not even sure is certainly Omicron related. But remember, we naturally are expecting a rise in COVID cases in the winter. So far, I can't see anything that is a substantial cause for concern. We know that Omicron is becoming dominant faster. However, again, when we couple it with severity and Omicron itself, I don't know that markets are going to continue to be substantially concerned about Omicron unless we got some form of a new report or new data set that indicated that, hey, sure, it might be taking over faster, it might be becoming the dominant variant faster, but honestly, a lot of folks are wondering, would it be better to have Omicron be the dominant variant over Delta because cases are less severe? Now, the downside might be we could potentially have more cases, and then the big question becomes, will that potentially lead to another variant? But the target's really focusing away from Omicron in terms of being the most severe cause for concern right now. And I think this is why the World Health Organization declares this variant a variant of concern rather than a higher, more exigent level. These are my thoughts and some research on Omicron. Thank you so very much for watching this. Let me know if you like this flow chart style presentation, and we'll see you in the next one. Thanks so much. Bye.